Hello everyone, in this video we'll discuss about emails, that is electronic mail. And here we'll discuss about SMTP protocol, POP protocol and IMAP protocol. All these three protocols, they are found at application layer. Email, it was invented at the beginning of the internet, so nowadays it is very popular and widely used application in the internet. Email, it is an asynchronous communication medium in which people send and read messages as convenience for them. That is, whenever they are interested, they are going to read the emails without disturbing the other's schedule. So earlier email, it was text based, but nowadays it is web based. The modern email has some of the powerful features, such as we have a messages with attachments, we can find the attachments nowadays, and we also have the hyperlinks, we can add hyperlinks to the existing text. We have HTML formatted text, that is the subject and everything which is in the readable format, it is called as HTML formatted text. We can embed photos, audio files and video files to the email. So these facilities, they help for the composing the email so that it is easily readable by the user. And email, it is a fast and easy to distribute and it is inexpensive compared to the traditional postal email. SMTP, it is pure text based protocol. That is, SMTP can only handle the messages containing 7-bit ASCII text, which means that it is in a readable format. The text is in the readable format. SMTP cannot transfer other types of data such as images, videos, audios, etc. It can only send a text file. For that purpose, we use the SMTP protocol. SMTP stands for Simple Mail Transfer Protocol. As the name indicates, it can only send a simple mail, that is a mail containing just a text file. So the name itself indicates Simple Mail Transfer Protocol. So it cannot transfer other data such as images, videos, audio files, etc. SMTP cannot transfer executable files and binary objects. So we cannot send files and many other objects with this emails. And it cannot also transfer text data of other languages such as French, Japanese and Chinese, because they are all only represented by 7-bit ASCII text. But representation of these kind of languages, it takes the representation in other format. So we had the limitations of SMTP as these, and to avoid these limitations, to overcome these limitations, we have extended the new factor, that is called as a MIME. MIME is, it is an extension to the SMTP protocol. It is used for multi-purpose internet email extension. So if we have a MIME along with SMTP, we can perform these functionalities, such as we can send audio video files along with the message. So MIME, it is an extension to an internet email protocol, that is SMTP protocol. It extends the limited capabilities of email by enabling the user to send and receive the graphics, audio files, video files, etc. in the message. And MIME was specifically, it was designed for SMTP. So if we have a MIME along with the SMTP protocol, we can send audio files, video files, and we can even send the text files in some other language. And executable files and objects can also be transferred along with the emails. And now let us know high level view of internet mail system. It has some key components, and here we have three major components. The first one is called as user agent, The second one is called as mail servers. Third one is SMTP protocol, that is simple mail transfer protocol. Now you can see a user agent here. User agent is the person who is called as a mail reader. The functionality of this user agent is to compose a mail, edit a mail, read the mail, and you can send the mail to the mail servers. So here user agent is the person who is going to read the mail and he is going to compose, edit and perform some activities, and that person is called as an user agent. Here we have an example of user agent such as Microsoft Outlook, Mozilla Thunderbird, iPhone mail client. These are considered as user agents, and outgoing and incoming messages are stored on the servers. Here we have the mail servers which are going to store the outgoing and incoming messages. Now the functionality of mail server. Mail server contains again two parts. The first one is mail box, second one is the mail queue. Mailbox contains all the incoming messages to the users. So it's going to contain the incoming messages are stored in the mailbox. Message queue, it's going to store all the outgoing messages that need to be sent to the other person. So they are stored in the form of queue. So they are called as message queue. You have the mail server which has a mailbox and a message queue. SMTP protocol, it's going to be present in between the mail servers. So this protocol works in between the mail servers. It is mainly used to send or receive the email messages. If you have a mail server and if it is sending a mail to some other mail server, then it is going to act as a client. If one of the server it is receiving the email from other mail server, then it is going to act as a server. So you have a client which is going to send the mail to the another server, and the server which is going to receive the email, it is called as a server. Here you can see an example. Here you have a traditional postal system which where a letter need to be posted from Delhi to Mumbai, and here you have a sender who is going to send a letter to the Delhi post office, and the functionality of this Delhi post office is to transfer the email, that is mail, from Delhi post office to the Mumbai post office, and Mumbai post office it's going to send the data back to the Mumbai to the receiver. This is the traditional working of email, that is the postal system. So here we have the sender and the receiver. A sender is going to send the email to the Delhi post office, and Delhi post office is going to send the message to the Mumbai post office, and Mumbai post office is going to send the message to the receiver. This is the traditional email system. Now we'll check the advancement. Here you have a postmaster who carries the message from sender to the Delhi post office. Let us see an email, how the email is going to work. It is similar to the earlier one. You have the sender and receiver. Sender is going to send the email to the sender's mail server. The functionality of the sender is to create or compose the mail. Then it will be stored in the sender's mail server. This sender's mail server, it is going to send the email to the receiver's mail server. And at the receiver mail server, whenever the receiver opens their email ID, it will be given to the receiver to read the email. So here the functionality of the postmaster here is it is going to carry the message from sender to the sender's mail server. It is done through an SMTP protocol. So SMTP protocol, it carries the mail from sender to a sender's mail server, and it's going to send the email from sender's mail server to the receiver mail server. Now we have the electronic mail, which is the SMTP protocol. So here SMTP protocol, it's going to use the TCP as the underlying transport layer protocol. So it is going to send the message from client to the server with the port number as 25. So the port number for SMTP is 25, and messages must be in the 7-bit ASCII format so that it is readable to the user. Here you can find a direct transfer of messages. That is, if you want to send a message to the another person, it will be directly sent to the mail server of the other person. There is no intermediate mail servers. So if one person want to send a message to the another person, mail to the another person, then it is sent directly to the other person's mail server without involvement of any intermediate mail servers. And all this sending of email, it's going to work in three phases. First one is handshaking, next one is transfer of messages, and third one is closure. Because it is going to use the underlying protocol, that is at the transport layer, it is going to use the TCP. And TCP also follows the three-way handshake. That is, first one is establishing the communication, that is the greetings. Next is the transfer of messages, and last one is the closing of connection. So the commands and responses interactions are like HTTP and FTP, and commands are in the form of ASCII text, and responses are nothing but the status codes and phrases. Here I have a scenario. Alice sends the message to the Bob. So Alice uses user agent to compose a message to Bob. So here you have a person, Alice, who is going to be acting as a user agent. And this user agent want to send a message to the Bob. You have the Bob at the other end here. And the mail ID of Bob is bob@someschool.edu. So Alice want to send a message to email bob@someschool.edu. So what this person does is, this person composes the email with the destination or a recipient email ID as bob@someschool.edu. After composing a email, Alice user agent sends message to her mail server, and message is placed in the message queue. So Alice sends the message to the mail server, that is Alice mail server. This is the sender mail server, and it is placed in a message queue. Here that message, it will be placed in the message queue. Now client side SMTP opens TCP connection with Bob's mail server. So after getting a email, it will check for the recipient address, and it opens a TCP connection with that particular email server, that is with the email address. So here you can find a mail server of the client, and here you can find the mail server of the recipient. So after receiving the mail from the user agent mail server, it opens the TCP connection with the recipient mail server. So it establishes the connection with the recipient mail server. Here you can find the fourth step. SMTP client sends Alice message over the TCP connection. So after establishing the connection, mail server, it's going to send the message to the recipient mail server. Bob's mail server places the message in Bob's mailbox. Then after receiving the email, mail server, it's going to place that message in the Bob's mailbox. And Bob invokes his user agent to read the message. So when the user is ready, that is when the Bob is ready, that person reads the message, and it's going to read the message by fetching from the mail server. This is how the email is going to work. Here you have a sample SMTP interaction. You have the communication between the client and server. Server is 220hamburger.edu, and the client, hello. The initial thing is from where the message is being sent, to whom it is being sent, and what you are interested to send, whether the recipient is okay to receive the data. And after some time, they are going to exchange the message, and after exchanging the message, they are going to quit the communication. Just now we saw that we have a three phases of transfer. Here you have the first phase, that is the interaction, that is handshaking phase, to whom it has to be sent, and from where you are going to receive, and exchange of data, and third one is quitting or closing the connection. SMTP is going to use the persistent connection. Persistent connection is the connection remains open even after sending one email. You have sent an email to the recipient and still the connection is open, and you can send one more email through the same connection, through the same TCP connection. SMTP requires message to be in the format of 7-bit ASCII, and 7-bit ASCII, it has to be common for header and body, both need to be in the 7-bit ASCII format. That is the message, whatever we are going to type, that is in the body part of the message. And SMTP server uses carriage return and line feed to determine the end of the message. When you are going to compare SMTP with HTTP, HTTP is called as pull protocol and SMTP is called as push protocol. Here there are two terms, one is pull and one more is push protocol. It is SMTP is called as push protocol because it is going to push the message from senders, that is the user agent, to the sender mail server. That is, from the sender it's going to send the push the message to the sender mail server, and again it's going to push the email from sender's mail server to the recipient mail server. So it is called as a push protocol, whereas in case of HTTP it is called as a pull protocol. So being a client, you request for an object and you are going to pull that object towards the client, so the display is again on the client side. So it is called as a pull protocol. Both have the ASCII commands and responses and interactions, and also have the status codes. HTTP, each object is encapsulated in its own response message. So whatever the object you have requested, that is sent along with an response message. And in case of SMTP, if you create one of the email, that email contains multiple objects within it as a part of the message. And that multiple objects can be text file, you have the audio file, video file, all of them are included in the message and they are considered as the part of a single message. So single message can contain multiple parts, such as audio files, video, text, and all of them, they are considered as a part of single message. And in case of HTTP, if you want to get an object and the object is text, then a separate connection is made for the text. A separate message is sent for the text, and if you want to access a image, then a new message is framed for the image. So all of them cannot be transmitted in a single response image. There need to be a separate response images for each object. You have the mail message format. You have the header. Header includes to, from, subject, CC and BCC. These are the common things that are present in the header. And next we have a blank line, which is going to difference between the header and a body. And this blank line contains CR and LF, that is carriage return and line feed, which is going to indicate the end of the header. And the next part is the body. Body contains the actual message that we need to send to the recipient, and it is mainly represented in a ASCII 7 characters. And you have something called as different from SMTP mail, that is from recipient to command, and these are also used in some of the emails. But the regular format what we are going to follow here is to, from, subject, and we also have CC, that is carbon copy, and BCC, and this is the general format that is used for the exchange of messages. You have the mail access protocols. There are three protocols which are called as mail access protocols. In general, we have three protocols. The first protocol is SMTP protocol. The second protocol is POP, and third one is called as IMAP protocol. You can see a diagram here. You have two persons and you have the Alice and Bob. When Alice creates or composes the email, it is given from user agent to the sender's mail server. And from sender's mail server, it is given to the receiver's mail server, and from receiver's email server, it is fetched to the user agent. Now, SMTP protocol, it is mainly used to transfer the email from or it is mainly used to push the email from user agent to the sender's mail server, from sender to the sender's mail server. Again, from sender's mail server, that email, it will be pushed to the recipient mail server, that is the receiver's mail server. And if the server is not online, then the server cannot read the message, or the sender, the receiver cannot read the email. That time it is going to reside in the receiver's mail server. And the, when the receiver is available, that time they can fetch it, then they can read the email. So to fetch the email into the user agent, from receiver's mail server to the receiver, it is done through POP and IMAP protocol. So SMTP, it is called as a push protocol, whereas POP and IMAP, they are called as pull protocol. So it is going to pull the message from receiver's mail server to the user agent. So here you can see SMTP, it's going to delivery or storage to the receiver's mail server. So it's going to SMTP protocol, it's the functionality of the SMTP protocol is still only the receiver's mail server, but not to the receiver. So mail access protocols, that is to access the mail at the receiver side, we use POP and IMAP protocol. POP, it is called as post office protocol, and it's mainly used for authorization. And IMAP is called as internet mail access protocol. It has some extra features compared to the POP protocol. We'll study these two in the next upcoming slides. Some of the examples are Gmail, Hotmail, Yahoo. These are some of the emails. And now we'll go with the POP. POP is called as post office with the version called as 3. So it is a POP 3. This protocol, it is used to fetch the mail from the receiver's mail service to the receiver. So it is extremely simple mail access protocol. Whenever the user want to read the email, then that person fetches the email from the mail server. So that fetching, it is done through POP. With the TCP connection established, POP 3 progresses through 3 phases. So whenever that person fetches the email, it is done through 3 phases. First one is authorization, transaction, and third one is update. Authorization is, a recipient has to log in to read the message. So the login process, it is done through an authorization. That is, we enter the username and password. So in authorization, the user agent sends a username and password to authenticate the user. After sending the username and password, it is going to fetch the data from recipient mail server to the user agent. So we can get a display that you have received a mail. We get a notification, or we get the received mail in the bold font, such as it has been not yet read. So that is called as a transaction. And in transaction, after accessing that, we can delete that email, we can remove the deletion marks, and we can obtain the mail statistics, that to whom all it has been sent and how many of them have read. Everything can be decided here. After receiving the email, we can mark the messages for deletion and remove the deletion marks, or we can consider them as read and unread. So these are considered as transactions. Now suppose we have chosen the deletion. Now after deleting, you need to update your mail server. So in update, after the quit command by client ending the POP3 session, the mail server deletes the marked messages. So that after selecting the deletion, the message gets deleted and your mail system gets updated. So POP3 is designed to delete mail on the server as soon as the user has downloaded it. So here you download a mail into your user agent, that is, you get it on your system. As soon as you get it on your system, the mail gets deleted in the recipient user mail server. Here you have the working of the POP protocol. The first phase is authorization phase. Authorization is, you enter the username and password. So check here, you have the server, POP3 server is ready. Client enters username and the username is Bob. So server is, as the username is correct, the server has given it as OK. And again the client enters the password, and the password is also correct, so user successfully logged in. This is the authentication phase. And we have the two responses, OK and error. OK we get it when the usernames and passwords are correct, and minus that is error we are going to get when they are not correct, when they do not match the data which is stored in the database. Now transaction phase, you can see the transaction here. A client, it's going to fetch the list. So the server is going to give the list of messages that are present in the mail server. As soon as you fetch a lot of messages, client retrieves the first message and its content. So you can see you can retrieve the content of message 1. The message 1 content has been displayed. And you delete after reading the message. Again retrieve 2, you read the content of the message, delete 2. And quit. POP3 server is signing off. So after reading all those messages, you delete them from the recipient server. Then you are going to quit the communication. And you have the IMAP, that is the Internet Mail Access Protocol. Just now I said this IMAP, it is a advanced version of POP. What is the disadvantage of POP is, so nowadays we have a lot of devices with us, such as we have a tab, we have a cell phone, and we have a laptops and many other devices. And in all those devices, we are going to log into our emails. Now you assume that you have logged into a tablet, and you are logged into a phone, and you are already logged into your email from the system. Now in all the three cases, you are logged in and you have already given the username and password. And if you receive a new email, then in case of POP, it is accessible. Suppose you have your cell phone with you right now, you can access that email on your cell phone, and as soon as it gets downloaded on your cell phone and you read it, your email is going to remain only in your cell phone. It will not get updated in your laptop or in your tablet. So it is only accessible through your cell phone. But in case of, if you use IMAP, it gets updated even in your cell phone as well as in your laptop and any other device you are going to use. So wherever your email is open, you can access that from that particular system. So it will be updated in all the devices, and you can access it from in all the devices. But if you are using POP, then it is only accessible in a device in which you have opened it for the first time. It will be downloaded in your device and it gets deleted in the recipient mail server if you are using the POP. But if you are using the IMAP, it's going to store in the mail server forever, and whenever you want, you can access it. So this is the advancement of IMAP. So you have a mail here. If even though you are received it on a system, it gets updated even in your cell phone and even on your tablet. So here it keeps all the messages in one place, that is at the server. But in case of POP, you can get all the messages on which device you have opened it, only on that particular device. The recipient can then move and organize the messages into a new user created folders, read the messages, delete the messages, and move the messages from one folder to the another folder, and so on. The whatever email we are going to use nowadays, it is going to work on IMAP. We can create many folders and you can move the messages from one folder to another folder, delete the message, we can read the message, and there are a lot of options available in the emails. To allow the users to search remote folders for messages matching specific criteria, we have a search option which is very helpful. And if we are interested to search for any particular email, we just type the email address of that particular person or a keyword, we can search for that particular file. Also permits a user agent to obtain components of messages. This is if we consider a email, we have received some email, that email contains both text as well as a file. If the user is interested only in a text, then they can access only the text. If the user is interested in text as well as the file, or if any image or audio file is present, they can access any part or any component of the message. It is depending upon the user. when low bandwidth connection between the user agent and its mail server, or even though there is a low bandwidth connection, still you can get a notification that some email has been received. In this case, user not to download all the messages in its mailbox, particularly avoiding long messages like an audio or video clips. They need not be downloaded to your system. They can still remain in the mail server at the recipient. Here we have some of the questions. Compare HTTP with SMTP. Explain SMTP. Illustrate the basic operation of SMTP with an example. Thank you.